taking a kid's phone is detrimental to a child's lifestyle. As soon as I took his phone, he immediately turned into a crackhead. Instantly. Instantly. I said, give me the phone. Give me the phone. You're not getting the phone back till you get your shit together. I snatched the phone. He broke down. He said, come on, daddy, don't do me like that. He started moving down. Don't do me like that, daddy.
And I do love being a parent. It's the most important thing I'll do in my life. But it's an insane proposition. You give your children everything. You give them everything. And then just one day they leave. They're like, see ya, thanks for nothing. I'll let you know if I need help with a mortgage. Sometimes they don't leave, right? They just stick around. They turn into roommates. Not gonna happen in my house. I already have a bag packed for each of them. I've seen the bags. They're like, what's that? I'm like, when you turn 18, that's your going away present. Jim, you're a monster. I try to be a good dad. I feel like I make more of an effort than my father. My dad's generation, they didn't have to do anything. My dad never went to a parent-teacher conference. My dad didn't even know I went to school. My father couldn't be bothered to turn his head if something was happening behind him.
What the hell's going on back there?
I don't know if he couldn't turn his head or if it wasn't worth the effort.
What the hell's going on back there?
We're celebrating my birthday.
Well, keep it down, I'm watching Ironsides.
Happy birthday to you. My children give me guilt trips I wouldn't even contemplate. Like my daughter was in a play on Thursday and Friday, so I went on Thursday night, and then Friday morning she saw me with my rolly bag and she was like, oh, you're not coming to my show tonight? I'm like, you've never been to one of my shows. I do 300 a year. My big plan was to teach my children responsibility by selling posters after one of my shows. So I texted my teenager, I'm like, do you want to sell posters after my show? I'll pay you. She texted back, great, sounds good. So then I texted my teenager, I'm like, do you want to sell posters after my show? I'll pay you. He texted back, no thanks, I don't need the money. He doesn't have any money. He has my money. I just texted back, you're out of the will. I'm kidding, he was never in it. If my father asked me to do something, he wouldn't even stick around for an answer. You wanna shovel the driveway? And then he'd just leave.
I got four daughters. I don't know what the fuck I did wrong or right. Four daughters, can you imagine? Oh, Lord. Because I've been running around lying to women and cheating on them and shit my whole life. God said, I got something for you, nigga. Yeah. You know, God from D.C., he said, I got something for you, Slim. Got something for you, Slim. Four daughters. No more skeeting on bitches' backs for me and none of that. Skeet on another bitch's back. I asked the doctor, what did I do wrong? He says, you gotta stop fucking women with dress socks on, Mike. I walk around butt naked with some dress socks on in the house. Yeah, it's cool to have daughters, you know, because you get to see your mother in them and shit. You see your mom. You're like, damn, girl, you remind me of my mama. You know what I mean? You get to see beautiful things when you got daughters, you know. But what fuck you up and make you mad, man, when they start dating? They start bringing little boys in the house. Because you don't know what the effect of having a daughter is until she bring a nigga in the house. My daughter's been bringing all little boys in the house that look like me. I want to kill every last one of them. I said, if you anything like I was, I'm going to fuck you up. This one, I really want to fuck him up. He be walking around looking at me, ha, 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 ha. This is a fucking tight pants ass little nut hugger. I'll be looking at him going like this.
Gang, 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 nigga.
One night I needed some weed. I couldn't find none. I called everybody. I said, I'm gonna try something. He was sitting in there. I said, hey man, you smoke weed? He said, no, I don't smoke no weed. I said, I knew he was lying. I said, okay. And before I can get out the door, he said, I know who got it. I said, oh yeah. Yeah, I know who got it, I know who got it. I said, is it good? He said, it's loud. I said, go get it. Man, I'm sitting there watching this little motherfucker. He walked out the back door and walked right back in the house. I said, I'm gonna fuck, I'm gonna slap the shit out of him as soon as I see him. I said, hello? Who the fuck you think I am? He was like, what, OG, I got that. I said, man, you had it on you. I said, get your ass in here. Because I still wanted it. I wasn't going to kick his ass out that house as long as I've been looking for this shit. I said, get your ass in here, man. Man, the weed was so good, I've been asking my daughter, where your little friend at? I kind of like him. I liked him too much. I got a granddaughter now.
My friend that I financially support had a kid, so I'm a dad. Yeah, I wasn't exactly ready for it. He gave me a call. He was all excited. He was like, yo, bro, I got great news. I was like, you got a job? And he was like, no, bro, I had a kid. And I was like, wow, that's like the exact opposite of a job. I can't wait to have a kid. I'm very excited. I don't think it's very hard at all. No, because all my friends are having them, and their complaints, they don't bother me very much. All their complaints are the same. They're like, bro, it cries. And I'm like, oh, man, go in the other room. Yeah, everything cries, you know? You try to make it stop, and then you leave. I cry all the time. Eventually, my friend's like, yo, dude, I got to go to work. I don't know, fucking figure it out. Get offline. So that, they say it cries. And the other complaint is they're like, yo, it like shits all the time. And that doesn't really bother me either because like, you know, so do I. You know, so I don't mind cleaning it up at like a smaller scale, you know? Plus when you clean kids, sometimes you see spots that like you might've missed on yourself, you know? Yeah, you know, you're like, wow, I've never seen my asshole from this angle before. You're like, I will dab that corner when I hop out the shower.
I got a whole gene. Look, let me tell you something. I'm showing my age now. I'm in my 40s, and this is what 40-year-olds do. They like match a bunch of shit that don't make no fucking sense. I got a whole jean suit on with a cowboy hat. This is a dad outfit for real. I'm the cool dad. You know who the fuck this is. Hey, I got a 13, 12-year-old, and a 5-year-old. I know, man. Like, fuck. You know what's funny? Like, when I was a younger parent, like, I tried to do all the things the right way. Now I don't really give a fuck no more, right? You know what I'm saying? Like, my five-year-old, we went to one of those jumpy things, and he just peed in that shit. And I'm like, oh, shit, let's just go. You know what I mean? I ain't changing. We just walked the fuck out of here. He was leaking the whole time. Nobody see shit. Come on, y'all. Damn. Hate being a fucking new dad again. Carrying that fucking car seat. People downplay that. Nobody realize how heavy it is to carry a human being with one fucking arm. That's stupid. And I don't give a shit. As long as they strapped in, I'm gonna carry that shit the best way I can. If you upside down, fuck it. I'm like, fuck it. No, I can't go to jail. He good, he's strapped in. As long as he don't fall out, we good. My daughter's 13. She's a fucking teenager now. She got the period. Ooh. That's right, it happened with me. I was hoping it was like, damn, you gotta be with me? Shit. Because I'm a divorced dad, so like, it was my time. And I'm like, wait a minute, why the fuck? I ain't ready for this, you know what I mean? I tried my best, Doug, and I ain't know what to get. I ain't gonna lie to you, I went to the store and got everything. I didn't know what the fuck to get. That lady was ringing me up like, what, you got a shelter or something? What you got all these different sizes for? What the fuck you got on, sir? What you got going on, sir? I ain't fucking know. I'm like, let me get the pad that absorbed the most. That's how, you know, man, we stupid. That's what we think, right? We think like, get the shit that absorbed the most. It's when I put all the shit on the table, and she's like, Dad, this is for grandma. I don't know what the fuck you think I got going. I'm 13, sir.
Our daughter is in third grade. And for first grade, she started taking the bus. And it was the first time she ever took the bus. So if you know as a parent, you walk them to the bus stop. It's very fun. And so we got her on the bus. She went to school. At the end of the school day, someone from the school called my cell phone. They have my wife's cell phone. They have my cell phone. They called my cell phone. And she said, hey, do you know what bus number your daughter's supposed to be on? And I said, I'm her dad. As in, are you crazy? Like, I was like, this is how you thought you would get this information? Was the call the dad? You saw a mom and dad's cell phone. You go, I bet the dad knows. I was like, do you have parents? Have you ever seen a family before? You thought, let's call the husband? Unless there's two husbands, you should never call a husband a day in your life. I would rather you ask a lady that doesn't know her. I think she could get to the bottom of it quicker than I can. I had to go get her. I go, all right, I'll come get her. Tell me the name of this school and I'll come get her. Where does she go?
And sons love everything their dads do. My kids would be at school the next day, just look like, oh, dad bit my sandwich. Oh, shit! Their dad is Dave Chappelle, man. You could trade that sandwich for something better. What I'm doing is adding value to their lunch.
My youngest is a boy. I have a 16-year-old boy in the house. Oh, anybody got a teenager? No? You probably do, but you don't have the energy to say anything. I don't know how to describe this kid. I really don't. He brags about things you shouldn't admit to. The other day, he walked through the kitchen, and he looks at us. I haven't showered in 4 days. Just likes to hurt us. He really likes to hurt us. And he's big. He's 6'5", my son. Yeah. Yeah, and he doesn't shower. There's a lot going on, man. There's a lot going on. Yeah, he's big. Plays varsity basketball. I'm not bragging. He's not that good. He's not that good. He's all right. He's all right. He'll get better. He played with a kid. He played 1 year with this kid who got drafted yesterday in the NBA, Aaron Holiday. Yeah. Yeah, he got to play with him. This was cool. The trainer called our house once and said Aaron bit Joe in the forehead. They were going up for a layup. Aaron's teeth went into Joe's head. And my wife got, you know, she's upset. Oh, he's going to need stitches. And then she got mad at me because all I could think was, maybe it's like a Spider-Man bite. Maybe I start going to the games now. Huh? Maybe Joe can dunk now. At 6'5". God forbid he jumps 4 inches off the ground and dunks for his father. Make an effort, Joe. And now he drives. Why do we give 16-year-olds licenses? My son doesn't care about anything. He called me the other day. He's like, hey, Dad, I'm in the car. Yeah, I don't know. I guess I'm out of gas right now. I'm like, ah! What do you mean you don't know, Joe? Are you moving? Is the car moving? And I'm moving, and I'm moving. I'm putting my foot on the pedal. I'm not going anywhere right now. All right, where are you, Joe? And he's very calm now. He's la-di-da. I'm here, I'm on the 101. The 101 is a 5-lane highway. Nothing. So I assume, like anybody would, oh, you're on the side of the road now? No, I'm in the middle lane right now. What do you mean, Joe? Where's the urgency? And I swear to you, this is the exchange, because I'm panicking now. What's the traffic like? Ah, well, behind me it's bad, but it's moving in front of me. I'm gonna kick your ass. I'm gonna kick your ass, Joe, because you need fear. You need fear in your life. And my wife tries to spin it. You know, whatever he does, she puts the spin on it. Well, he doesn't panic, he's zen. He's a very zen-like boy. Like astronauts. Maybe he'll be an astronaut one day. Oh, you think so? Really? I don't want to burst your bubble, but if he can't interpret the gas gauge on a Mazda,
Nah, he ain't getting in the space shuttle. I'll tell you right now. Give that up. That kid is not an astronaut. Unless an astronaut bites him. If an astronaut bites him, then we got a chance.
I had to take my son's phone from him, which is the worst things you can do to a child. Taking a kid's phone is detrimental to a child's lifestyle. As soon as I took his phone, he immediately turned into a crackhead. Instantly. Instantly. I said, give me the phone. Give me the phone. You're not getting the phone back till you get your shit together. I snatched the phone. He broke down. He said, come on, daddy, don't do me like that. He started moving down. Don't do me like that, daddy. He said, take my leg instead. Take my leg. What? Well, give me the goddamn phone. You're not getting the phone back till you get your shit together. When I take the phone, I say to myself, you know what? I need to go through my son's phone. I need to see what my son has been talking about on his goddamn phone. It's irresponsible on my part as a parent to not know what's on my son's phone. I go through the phone, people, I realize I don't have the code. I don't got the thumbprint, the face ID, nothing. So I gotta go back to this little nigga and ask him to put the goddamn code in the phone. Put the code in the phone so I can see what you've been talking about. Straight face, my son said, nah, man, I ain't gonna do it. I said, what? Boy, put the code in the phone before I punch you in the fucking throat. That's what I said. I said that. He took off running. Like he don't live in this house. Like I'm not gonna see him at the dinner table in 10 minutes. I said, anybody chasing you, give me the code to the phone before I kick you in the back. Swear to God, from downstairs, all I heard was, fuck you! I'ma kill him. I'm about to kill him. I run downstairs, grab my son by the neck. I start choking the shit out of my son. What the fuck you say to me? He couldn't breathe. He said, that's the code. The code is fuck you. Oh. That's a good code, son. That's a good code. Is it Y-O-U or the letter U? How you spell it?
The other crazy thing about being a dad is you just aren't a dad and then you are. It changes immediately. And I feel like for a mother, you know your body is telling you that a change is coming and you feel like a mother before the moment actually happens. But you just are not a dad and then you are a dad. And that became very clear to me after our first son was born, about 2 hours after. We were in the hospital and he's asleep and my wife's asleep and a nurse brings me some paperwork to fill out. And the first question was mother's name, and I put my wife's name. And then it said mother's phone number, and I put my wife's phone number. And then it said father's name, and I put my wife's father's name. And then it said father's phone number, and I thought, who the fuck knows their father-in-law's phone number? And then I realized, oh, I'm the father. I hope I can be as good of a father to my kids as my dad was to me and my brother. My dad was an incredible father, so supportive, our best friend even to this day. And there are things that I want to emulate in the way that he raised us. One thing I'm really looking forward to is trying to be the kind of disciplinarian that my dad was, because he really seemed to enjoy it. He was never physical or threatening. He used a technique that I believe cognitive psychologists would refer to as mind fuckery. I remember there was this time, there was a storm in our town and knocked down a tree in our backyard, and the town came and took the tree, but they left the stump. And my dad thought the stump was an eyesore, and it really drove him crazy that he had this ugly stump in his front lawn. And so one day, we were driving to school, and one of our neighbors had a landscaping crew there, and my dad stopped the car and he got out, and he went over to the foreman and said, hey, if I gave you $100, would you get rid of this stump using your bulldozer? And the guy said, sure, I can do that. And so my dad took us to school and went to work, and that night he got home and the stump was still there. Next day, stopped again. The guy said, we got busy, we'll get rid of the stump. Again, school, work, came home, stump was still there. My dad was so mad that the stump was still there. It was all he talked about. It was the week we found out the incredibly high bar he had for the customer service he expected of under the table stump removal. So finally, after about a week, we're driving to school and my dad stops the car and turns around to my brother and I and says, everything's gonna be fine, which is a terrifying thing to hear. If it never even occurred to you, everything would not be fine. It sounds like a positive thing, but in context, it's very negative. It would be like if a surgeon right before you went under said to you, I hope we meet again. So my dad said everything's gonna be fine, and he gets out of the car, and he walks over, and in his business suit, he lies down in front of the bulldozer. Lies down on the ground in front of the bulldozer. And then, as you would do if you were a landscaping crew and you saw this happen, they all walked over, and the foreman said, hey man, what are you doing? And my dad looked at him and said, I'm so depressed about the stump in my lawn that I don't wanna live anymore. Will you please run me over with your bulldozer? And the foreman said, man, you gotta get up. My dad said, I can't get up. I'm too sad. From, you know, the stump. And so they looked at my dad, and then they looked at my brother and I with our faces pressed against the window. And he said, man, I promise, if you get up right now and get in your car, I will turn this bulldozer around. The stump will be gone by lunch. My dad said, he promised? He said, I promise. My dad got back in the car, and we drove off, and we watched the bulldozer turn around and go the other way. And it was a very quiet and awkward drive. And then finally, after about 10 minutes of silence, my brother said, why would you do that with us in the car? And my dad, with no hesitation, said, oh, it wouldn't have worked without you in the car.